example of what America is going through as far as its pain management mentality is concerned, and that's how the markets are now starting to operate, that every time something goes wrong, even if it doesn't have a systemic impact, the government intervenes and steps in.
Yeah, so the example that you're talking about is one of my favorite analogies in the book, which is the fact that in America they have an opiate crisis, where, you know, and the reason why they have this opiate crisis is, as many medical people have now have said, is that the slightest hint of any pain, you administer opiates. So you become hooked then, you know, like on opiates in terms of that. And you have so many people, you have so many movies, yeah, anything else which have been made documenting that. So the same approach now has come to economic management, which is that at the slightest hint of trouble, you administer stimulus or you do like a rescue. It's no longer very selective. Even in America, and this is what I find it like really fascinating, the concept of bailing out private sector companies was considered completely heretical until the 1980s.
Yeah.
So, like, before that, the private sector was supposed to operate on its own, and the government was not supposed to come to the rescue if any companies got in trouble. Mm. In the 1970s, we got the first calls for such bailouts, and it was met with a lot of opposition, including from politicians. Then, and this is the irony of it, that in the middle of the so-called Reagan-Thatcher revolution, which we thought is all about free markets doing well, in 1984, the first big bailout of an American financial institution takes place. That's Continental Illinois. And after that, there's been no looking back, which is that one after another, every time there's been a crisis, whether the savings and loans crisis in the late 1980s, then LTCM, which happened in 1998, and then you had in 2008, of course, all the bailouts, and then the pandemic, and then last year, in 2023, you have Silicon Valley Bank, you know, like a bank of rich depositors, and that sort of runs into trouble. And then once again, the government there decides that it needs to bail out, so the depositors don't take any haircut.
Yeah.
And, you know, like they're bailed out. And like, who's getting bailed out here? And this has many negative consequences.
Like,
you know, this is all about some abstract modern hazard concept. No, there are two very tangible negative
deficits and debt.
No, I'd say this is a, like a bit different, because like often when the government bails out, it's not even using any money. It's just sort of saying that we are here to backstop it. Mm. Now you argue, what's the price of this? Because, you know, like debt and deficits, there's a clear price. Well, there are two prices here. One, that the average person really feels very miffed about this. Mm. That these big guys are getting bailed out, you know, in terms of that. And here, even in 2008, small community banks went bust and stuff. Yet the big financial institutions got bailed out. So there's a lot of resentment that
which
comes
is what
in.
Gives capitalism its bad name.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know that, okay, who is this for? Who's capitalism for?
Yeah.
Why are these big fat cats getting bailed out in terms of it? Or like these rich deposits getting bailed out? And the second thing, which I think is something I've spent a lot of time in the book, is that the ultimate paradox, that why is productivity growth in the Western world, in America included, declining?
Yeah.
That we are in the midst of this incredible tech boom, which is taking place, and yet productivity growth, which is the key to economic growth. Remember, the key to economic growth is productivity growth. Why is this declining? And I think that once again here, like the sort of answer is that because of the fact that you have so this dynamism has been lost, because you're bailing out companies, you're keeping alive so many deadwood companies.
Zombie companies.
I mean, that's a great point that you brought up. You know, like one example out there that I have in the book is that once again, that in the 1990s or so, this term zombie companies became a bit popular.
Yeah.
Why? Because Japan, the economy and the markets were going bust, and the Japanese corporations and the Japanese government and all were keeping alive a lot of smaller companies which were very inefficient, rescued by easy money. So the term zombie companies became popular. The American media, as I document in the book, you know, and this is fascinating, back in the 1990s and all, including the New York Times and all, you know, which are sort of left-leaning liberal entities, they would mock the Japanese, saying that that happens in Japan. This, America doesn't do this.
Yeah.
That was the kind of attitude. At that point in time, the number of zombie companies in America as a share of the total was like 2% or something like that.
Today?
Fast forward today. Today, by some measures, including by institutions such as the Bank of Financial Settlements or so, nearly 20% of all companies in America can be classified as zombie companies. What are these companies? These are companies that are not able to earn enough to cover their interest and debt payments. So they have to keep going to the market every year.
Yeah.
For 3 years in a row, they've been doing that, and they get classified as zombie companies. So you have, like, in terms of to imagine that
20%.
That, like, in the heart of capitalism, this is what's happening. And in Europe, it's even worse in terms of in places like UK and all the number of zombie companies is even more. So in Western societies here, zombieism has now become, so it's become a zombification of capitalism. That's what's taking place out here.
Socializing risks and zombification of capitalism. Those are nice headlines that you've given us, Richard. But you know.